Hello, everybody, and welcome to our Be a Councillor event. It's really great to have you with us. I'm Zina Etheridge. I'm the Chief Executive of the Council. And we've got some other people with us to help explain a bit more about what being a councillor is like. And in a moment, they will all introduce themselves. They're all existing councillors in Haringey. And then we've got also along with us, our monitoring officer, Fiona Alderman, who will talk you through in a bit more detail how you go about becoming a councillor, some of the technical details. We'll have lots of opportunities for questions as we go through. And I think we've also got some pre-submitted questions, so we'll make sure we answer those as well. But first off, I was just going to start by just explaining a little bit about what the council does. And this is just a very, very brief snapshot. First of all, though, I'm sure anybody joining this event knows what Haringey is like and knows all about Haringey. But just a very brief summary for anybody who's relatively new. It's obviously a really, really diverse borough. With about 180 languages spoken in the borough. And that's one of the reasons why we were keen to run this event, to make sure that as wide a range of people as possible, from as many different backgrounds as possible, understand that they can become a councillor and understand the advantages of doing so and understand how doing so can be really, really good for other members of your community. The population's about 270,000, and currently we've got 19 wards, each represented by three councillors. And that's changing slightly from next year after a review of our ward boundaries by the Local Government Boundary Commission. And so from next May, we'll have 21 wards, most of which will still have three members, but six of those wards will have two members. Just very briefly, what does the council do? I always say that the best way of thinking about a local authority is thinking about it as government locally. So we do an awful lot of the things that government does, but locally. Obviously, we don't have a foreign policy or a defence policy, but we do get involved in all sorts of other things. And we have hundreds of services and get involved in hundreds and hundreds of different things. But just a very brief snapshot of some of the main things that we do. So we run children's social care. And support some of the most vulnerable children in our communities. We support children's centres and early years and youth services. We provide adult social care, both providing care and support to those who need it, rehab services, things like that, enablement services, but also social work assessments. We provide public health, and obviously that's been a really important function over the last year and a half with the COVID pandemic. We provide housing and homelessness services, including building new council homes. We maintain roads and pavements. We look after parks and open spaces and sometimes even create new parks. And we work with the police to help make sure our communities stay safe. We work with communities, and in fact, we've got a legal duty to work with our communities to promote cohesive communities. We're the local planning authority. We provide support to businesses, we provide libraries, and we work closely with lots and lots of other organisations in the private sector, but also in the public sector and voluntary sector, to work together to make our community and make sure that Haringey is as great a place as possible to live and that the people who live in Haringey are able to thrive and meet their potential. The role of a councillor within all of that is to develop overall strategies and plans to serve the community and to represent the community and to take decisions. So many of the things that the council formally does have to be taken as formal public decisions and taken in public so that they're fully transparent and everybody can see the reasons for the decision and the background information to it. You can be a councillor who's in the administration, who is in charge of the council, or you can be a councillor from the opposition, or you can be an independent member. And today we've got part of the administration, including the leader, to talk to you, but we've also got the leader of the opposition, Councillor Corley Harrison, and Councillor Palmer, who's also in the opposition group. You can do all of the kind of functions that I've been talking about through talking to your constituents informally and through surgeries and meetings, through managing casework, through political or group meetings you go to, through community meetings, through working on specific projects, and also by representing the council in other fora, including sometimes an regional or sub-regional meetings. So that's a very, very quick snapshot of what councillors do. And we can cover some of that more in questions. But I think the best way of getting a feel for what councillors do is to hear from some of our councillors. So I'm going to hand over first off to Councillor Pariah-Armitt, who's the leader of the council.
Thank you, Zina. And thankfully this time my voice is working okay, because the last time we did this I had a touch of laryngitis. So I'm Councillor Pariah-Armitt and I'm the leader of the council. I also represent Knoll Park Ward, which is Central Wood Green, and I've represented Knoll Park since 2014. So this is my second term as a councillor. I'm a Labour councillor, and the reason I'm leader of the council is because the Labour Party hold the majority of seats on the council, and you'll be hearing from the Leader of the Opposition a bit later on as well. So just a little bit about me specifically. So I was born and raised in Haringey, specifically Wood Green. I went to primary and secondary school in the borough, and I've worked in the public sector in various roles, including working for Haringey Council, actually, some years back. And I've worked in the public sector, done lots of frontline work with children and young people. I've set up drug services and just done various roles within this kind of section. So that's my main interest before I become a councillor was what we term people services, so young people and children predominantly. But when I became a councillor in 2014, my first role was as planning chair. And I think that's really important, because I think when you become interested in becoming a councillor, the main thing that drove me and drive lots of people is the want and the need to serve your community, really. You know, having a passion for Haringey and having a passion for your local community is what drives you to become a councillor and to make a difference, to be involved in decision making at that strategic level and at that local democratic level. So when I become a councillor, you know, that was my driving force. You know, it was kind of being an active person within Wood Green and Haringey more widely. And my first role was as chair of planning, which was quite different for somebody like me who had previously, as I said, most of my background has been in people type of services. But that's the exciting thing about being a councillor. You get to do things and you get to take part in decisions in areas that perhaps you've never dealt with before. You know, you quickly build up your experience, and of course there's lots of papers for you to read, and we have officers who are experts within these areas who are on hand to advise us. But it certainly opens up a whole realm of possibilities and you know, sort of challenges what you know. And you know, often I can now look back after 7 years and see lots of examples of things that I was directly involved in that have now, you know, come to fruition. So for example, the Spurs planning application, I was the chair of the planning committee when that was decided, and as anyone watching and listening knows, that stadium's now been built and has been operating for a number of years. So really today is about, you know, encouraging as many people as possible, and as the chief exec outlined, it's really important that the council and councillors reflect the diverse communities we serve. I am a BAME woman from a working class background. You know, my parents were immigrants from Cyprus. They came here in the 1950s and 60s, and English was their second language. And you know, it's just, you know, it's just a demonstration that anything's possible, really. And you know, my parents both left school at 11 and had various jobs that included, you know, working in the service industry. Mum was a seamstress at the time. So anything is possible, and it's really important that we attract as much of a diverse group of people as possible. And you know, ensuring that you know, if you want to get involved, you do get involved, and you don't let anything hold you back. So I'll leave it there. But all I will say is the main thing that you must think about is why do I want to be a councillor? And I think for me, it was all about making a difference to my local community, to the community that I've lived in for my whole life.
Thank you, Councillor Armitt. And I'm sure we'll be able to hear more about that as we answer some questions a bit later on. Councillor Corley Harrison, can I bring you in next?
Thanks, Zina. So my name is Luke Corley Harrison. I am a Liberal Democrat councillor in Crouch End and the leader of the opposition in Haringey. For those of you not familiar with the differences between the various parties in the UK, our party, the Liberal Democrats, or Lib Dems, we're often referred to, are fundamentally based on the principles of liberalism. So that means we strongly believe in individual rights, equal distribution of wealth, so everyone has the same opportunities in life. And it's important to us that through a democratic system, power is dispersed to individuals and communities, those that are affected by the decisions being made, rather than a kind of top-down approach of decision-making. You may also know the Lib Dems as being very pro-European, pro-environmentalists. So if you're not aligned to a particular political party, please do have a little look around at all of the parties, see whether kind of any are of interest to you, and do engage with them if you are interested in becoming a councillor. I also mentioned I'm the leader of the opposition in Haringey. That's probably a term some people may not be familiar with. The opposition group generally means the party with the second highest number of seats within a particular democratic setup, so in this case, a local authority. So here in Haringey, there's 41 Labour councillors, 15 Lib Dem councillors, and at the moment one independent. By virtue of being, like Councillor Armet, leader of my group, I'm also therefore the leader of the opposition. And the role of the opposition is essentially to provide scrutiny or checks and balances over the decisions the majority party as a whole, or the leader and the cabinet members make. We do that by providing challenge on decisions, as well as sitting on committees and cross-party groups within the council to probe policies and the delivery of the majority group's plans. But we can also put forward our own policy amendments or ideas, as well as our own budget proposals each year that differ from the majority group. And we may touch on that further. Whilst I'm leader of the opposition, I'm also, like all councillors, a ward councillor as well, which means alongside my ward colleagues in Crouch End, including Councillor Palmer, who will speak shortly, I represent a specific area of Haringey, assisting the residents that live in that area and businesses that operate within that area, and being an advocate to the council for improving, in my case, Crouch End, in line with kind of our beliefs and the beliefs of the residents there. I was elected for the first time in 2018. So unlike some of the other speakers, this is my first term as a councillor. And I've also had two children since being elected. I have a job outside of being a councillor, which is all challenging, but they're not barriers to anyone becoming a councillor. So don't kind of let anyone make you think that because you have a job, you can't also be a councillor. You absolutely can. The majority of our group certainly do. It's challenging, but it's also incredibly rewarding to do so. And for me, I decided to run as a councillor, as a Crouch End resident, because I wanted, like Perai, better for the area that I lived. I wanted to make improvements. And I think that's often why a lot of people want to become a councillor for the area directly where they live or work. Hopefully I've gone some way to make that happen as a councillor so far, and we'll continue to do so, hopefully. Thanks, Zina.
Thank you very much, Councillor Corley Harrison. We're going now to the Mayor of Haringey, Councillor Jogi.
Thank you, Zina. I hope everybody can hear me. Greetings all. My name is Adam Jogi and I'm the Mayor of Haringey. And I'm sorry that we can't all be together in person to say hello and to speak about our community and why it's so important that people put their hands up and stand for office. But alas, we are still in a semi-hybrid get out of the pandemic mode. So I'm 29 and I'm the Labour councillor in, or one of the Labour councillors in Hornsey, which my colleagues on this Zoom won't be surprised to hear, I think is the centre of our borough and the centre of the universe in so many ways. I've lived in Hornsey my entire life. And so as well as being somewhere I work, it's also my home and where my family and friends live. And I'm particularly pleased that our ward has elected at least one black councillor since the turn of the century, which is something that I think is really important. And I'm pretty lucky, I think, to have the opportunity to live in my ward too, and to have a direct and daily experience of the issues affecting the people I represent and live amongst, and in my case, grew up with. Now, you don't have to live in your ward to represent it, but there are some real benefits to doing so. And I see Councillor Adam, who is nodding there, and Gina was elected before I was born. So there's some longevity to this gig as well. Now, I was elected in May 2014 at the age of 22, at the same time I was doing my finals. So it was a completely nuts personal period for me, but I was able to work my way through. I was baby-faced with no grey hair back then, but I can see on this call the grey hair is now pretty obvious. I was the youngest councillor in my first term, but that changed with the election of some of our Liberal Democrat colleagues in 2018. And I was re-elected in the 2018 election and most recently elected Haringey's first Muslim mayor in October last year. Now, in so many ways, standing for the council is one of the best decisions I've ever made. I don't always regret it, but I do sometimes question it. But there's no better feeling than the one you get having helped somebody get a safe and secure place to live or a long-standing local issue resolved. Or more recently, in a haunty context, making sure our drains are unblocked and maintained. So if you care about something, put your hand up and think about standing for the council. Every Friday, as mayor, I speak at the citizenship ceremonies that see local people sworn in and take the oath as British citizens. And I always tell them, I always say to them and encourage them as they protect, defend and use their new British rights and privileges, that irrespective of which party they think best reflects their values, to get involved, to vote and to get active. And I want to make that plea to all of those people today, whichever your party, as Luke noted earlier, you think best reflects your values, get involved, turn up, be seen, be heard and have your say. Now, I've seen some colleagues, and I'm sure Gina will have seen even more than me, who haven't always found the balance right, and they found it difficult to get their groove. And so in some ways, cases have only done 4 years, others have not even done that. But my advice to anybody is to embrace this role, make it part of your life, and you'll find it much easier to keep up with the demands of the job and the expectations of local residents. When I was first elected, I was given one piece of advice, well, plenty of advice, but one particular piece of advice that I've kept with me since, and that was from the late George Meehan, who was leader of the council at three different times, who told me to always read my papers, read every page, because that's where the detail is, the facts are, and as councillors, we're here to deliver good policy and real results for people, and you don't know how to do that, or you're not best placed to do that unless you know exactly the state of affairs. Now, our council will only ever be as representative of the community it serves if people from across that community, those of all faiths, genders, class, age, colour, and occupation, get involved and get active. In my case, it hasn't always been easy. Youth doesn't always see you get taken as seriously or treated with quite the respect you need to or deserve to. And there are political challenges and obstacles in your own party. There's a battle to win, but also get on with those in other parties. But for all the stresses, hassles, and effort that goes into helping those most in need, it is for sure a worthwhile thing to do. And as the leader of the opposition noted earlier, most of us have a job. A number of us have got full-time jobs, certainly the younger ones. And the balance can be struck between your private life, your work life, and your commitments as a councillor if you want it to happen. Now, Haringey's greatest strength is its diversity. I'm sure my colleagues are bored of hearing me say that in all the speeches they have to listen to me give, but I think that's true. And so you'll help us move our community forward by you thinking of standing and getting involved. And that diversity is extended to the different elements of our council's responsibilities that you'll engage with as a councillor, from keeping our streets clean to ensuring our adult social services are fit for purpose, from fighting the climate emergency to delivering good quality, affordable and secure housing for people. So my message to anyone who cares about the community you live, learn and work in, who cares and wants to change the world, is please think about standing for the council. I'm always here and happy to help. So if you're watching this and are interested, by all means, come and see me in the mayor's parlour for a cup of tea, and I'm happy to answer any questions today or any that come to your mind afterwards. Thank you and good luck.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Councillor Jogi. It's a tempting offer, tea in the mayor's parlour. So should we go to Councillor Adamu next, please?
At my own cost, I should confirm.
hello, everyone. Thank you, Zina. My name is Gina Damo. I'm a councillor for Haringey Ward, one of three councillors, along with my colleagues, Sarah and Zina. I also live in my ward, and I have been living here for a long, long time. Say something about me, why I decided to stand for the council. It wasn't an easy decision. I was a member of the Labour Party, but I had, like my colleagues said, they had full-time jobs, so did I. I had a full-time job, I had three young children. And at the beginning, I only helped around canvassing for for the party or for a normal, I remember the first time I went to canvas, it was with Norman Atkinson, was then the Tottenham MP. And believe it or not, I have canvassed with Bernie Grant and David Lammy. So I have been privileged to know all our MPs. The reason I decided to stand for the council, even though I was a very busy mom working mom with three children at the time, very young children, I may add, it was simply as this. I felt we didn't have enough women on the council at the time, that it was certainly not enough for women from ethnic minorities. And more important, it wasn't enough women like me, working moms. I've had working mothers from my background didn't have a voice, basically. And I wanted to be a voice, speak for the ordinary woman. And I hope I have done over the years. The role of councillors. When I first went on the council, it was 1990, by the way. And I met our mayor now, Adam, when he was a school kid. And I was the mayor. He shot on me for a day. And he was very interested. And I knew then that this young man is going to be join us one day soon, and he has. I've done different jobs over the years. The first job I did on the council was being a chair of social services. It was a very large committee at the time. We had something like 14 councillors sitting on the committee. We had co-chairs from different services, most from the voluntary sector. Mind in Haringey was children with disabilities, a son who had the number, and we did a lot of good work. We worked even then, public health was a part of the council, but we worked closely with the health authority at the time. And I done different things. I have been on many committees, housing committees, planning, licensing. And more recently, I was involved in scrutiny. Now I chair the licensing committee, and I'm also on planning committee. There have been times when I ask myself, every 4 years, I usually ask myself, do I want to do this again? Now I'm retired. Obviously, I have more time on my hand, but that's not the reason why I'm doing it. As I said, I'm sure I said it before, and do forgive me if you heard this before. But for me, I think what makes me decide to do another 4 years every time is the casework. It's the difference we make in somebody's life, you know, when they come to see you, whatever they are, older people, whatever they need help with moving into shelter accommodation, whatever they need care packages, whatever their parents, environmental issues. Some people with mental health, all sorts of problems. And over the years, I have many times been very able to help people, and people come back and say, thank you so much, you made a difference to my life. And I think that's what makes me really want to do it. Sometimes it's more difficult to help people, I have to say. You advise them, they may need legal advice, or you advise them where to move on. Or even put a complaint, because you have a complaining procedure. It's not a lack of trying, believe me. I always try very hard to help people. I think the council should represent the community. And in Haringey, we have a multicultural, multi-faith community, and we have to represent the community. So it's important to have people on the standing as councillors from all backgrounds. Males and females, people with disabilities, people who simply want to make a difference. And that's what it comes down to it. If you want to make a difference, please think about this seriously. I always been passionate about people, and I spent years on social care, social services, and I was on adoption panel for city, a panel for children. I care greatly about children at risk. And my heart goes out to every time there is something goes wrong, put it this way. But at the end of the day, we are here to be all of us, whatever the whatever party or political views we have, people who stand on the council is because we want to make a difference. We want to give some something back to our community. And I personally want to encourage people to stand for the council, and people from ethnic minorities, I may say, the younger people, sometimes they think all politicians are the same, they're not interested. Well, we're not the same. And it is important that we, you know, we are interested in politics, because whatever we do in life, politics affect our lives, whatever we do. So it's important that people do care. And I think I finish at that, and I'm happy to take part in answering your questions. Thank you, Zina.
Thank you, Councillor Adamy. And as Chief Executive, I can absolutely confirm that all of our 57 councillors are very different people, whichever party they belong to. So last but very much not least, Councillor Palmer.
Thank you. So my name's Tammy Palmer, and I'm a Lib Dem councillor in Crouch End, and I'm also the opposition children and family spokesperson. So probably like everybody else, I wanted to become a councillor because I really wanted to make a positive impact on the place that I live and the place that I'm raising my family in. So I'm really passionate about tackling inequality, the environment and education. And although I'd been a real champion for change for a long time, both as an activist and in my professional career, I really wanted to make a change politically. So like Luke, I was elected in 2018, and I've balanced having a full-time and very senior career and having a young child and being a councillor. So for me, taking the children and families role was the perfect opportunity to really make a difference to the lives of children, young people and their families here in Haringey. And I see the children's scrutiny panel on which I sit as a really vital part of that. So scrutiny isn't about being political. We work together, and it's about taking a really deep dive into the services that we're offering, really listening to and working collaboratively with all of our stakeholders to ensure that we continually improve our offer. And one of the other really important aspects of council life for me is being a corporate parent. And not many people outside of the council know very much about this. But as somebody who spent their whole childhood in foster care, it's really, really important to me. So every single councillor is a corporate parent, and we all have responsibility for our looks after children and young people. And I also sit on our corporate parenting committee. So that's a space in which we listen to our looks after children and young people, and we really work on their recommendations to help guide how we improve our services. So just recently, I had the pleasure of hearing from two of our care leavers who had secured Oxbridge places to study and wanted to give us some feedback on that. And I think to finish on, it can be really hard when you're an opposition councillor to see how you make those really important changes happen, and you aren't in power. But I'm really proud to have put forward motions on things like putting school streets in place across the borough, to have supported the inclusive education motion, to have spoken on debates on tackling violent crime, tackling climate change, supporting young people with autism into the workplace, and jointly proposing with Labour colleagues the Reclaim Our Streets motion. So my son is incredibly proud of what his mum does when she disappears for a lot of hours every week. And sometimes he doesn't even refer to me as mum when he introduces me to people. He always says, "This is Councillor Palmer. She is my mum, but she wants to help people." And I think that really sums it up for me. I think sometimes we can't always give people the responses that they want, but in our role as public servants, we should always be doing whatever possible to make life in Haringey the very best we can for all of our residents. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councillor Palmer. It was a great note to end on. I'm going to do some questions to the panel from people who are both at the event today and who've pre-submitted questions. So first off, and I'm going to ask a couple of different members. So I'm going to start with Councillor Palmer, since I can see her on my screen. How much time do you have to commit to the role, Councillor Palmer?
I think it really varies. So I sit on children's scrutiny, which is quite a big commitment. So we have our kind of big key scrutiny meetings, and then we also have lots of evidence gathering sessions. And then obviously you have your casework and full council meetings, and I sit on corporate parenting as well. So it's probably, gosh, it's anything from sort of 10, 15 hours a week sometimes. You kind of sandwich it all in. You do lots of work at the weekends and in the evenings. You get to go to lots of great events as well. You get fed very well as a councillor.
Thank you very much. There's a whole other question coming about diet and being a councillor, I think. And can I ask the same question to Councillor Armett? Obviously, you've got a very different role, Councillor Armett. I wonder if you want to say something about the time commitment.
Yeah, as I said before, I'm probably the worst person to ask because as leader of the council, obviously, it's a full-time job for me. So it does take up a lot of time and commitment. And as others have said on the call today, it's I'm a working mum as well, so juggling lots of things. But really, being on the council is essentially how long's a piece of string. So depending on the role you do, then your time commitment is determined by that. And for some, they may have full-time jobs and they choose to just have a role as a ward councillor, which is perfectly right, and sit on a couple of committees. So I think it's essentially, you know, that starts with that first commitment, and the rest of it is really about how much time you've got and how much you want to commit to the role.
Great, thank you very much. And I'll ask you this the next question, Councillor Armett. Do I get paid as a councillor, or is it a voluntary role?
So you receive an allowance. So there's a basic allowance which is determined by full council, so it's all very official and it's open and transparent information. So all councillors will get a basic allowance of £11,000, I believe. And then if you have an extra role, what we call a special response, you get what we call a special responsibility allowance, and that will depend on the role. And again, this is all formally decided and constituted as well. So the leader, the cabinet, various committee chairs and the leader of the opposition, chief whips, will all receive a special responsibility allowance. But this is all in the public domain.
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask a couple of questions to Councillor Crawley-Harrison next. Councillor Crawley-Harrison, I'm picking you because you were the first person to touch on this. So one of the questions we've got is, do I need to be a member of a political party to be a councillor?
No, absolutely you do not. You can run as an independent councillor, and there are plenty that do up and down the country. There are some majority groups that have a lot of independent councillors that help run their administrations. No, there is support from the Local Government Association for people that might be running as independent councillors as well. That's the LGA, and you can check their website. They have specific support staff for potential independent councillors and then elected independent councillors as well. You may prefer the option of running within a political party. For example, if you're already a member, that would be one obvious one. But also if their views align more with your own views, there are some benefits. For example, there's resourcing benefits from having others around you that are also running the machine, if you like, of having a political party behind you as well. And also when you are running, there are some administrative submissions you need to make through what's called an agent, and it can be beneficial to have a political party sort of managing the agent process on your behalf, rather than you having to source sort of friends or family to operate as your agent. But absolutely not, no, you do not need to be running as a candidate for a political party to become a councillor.
Great, thank you. And I'm going to put this question to somebody else as well, but I'm going to start with you. Can you have, and some councillors have already talked a bit about this, but can you have another job at the same time as being a councillor?
You can, and it's for you to manage your own time, really, and manage your own resources. Obviously, there are some roles, as Per I mentioned, where there is a level of expectation in terms of how much time you need to give to the job. Leader of the council, the obvious one, which may mean that having a full-time job is difficult whilst running a council, I would suggest. No, there aren't necessarily kind of de facto restrictions. There are some jobs that prevent you from running as a councillor. For example, politically restricted jobs, or if you work as a teacher for a local authority run school in the local authority with which you want to run. So if you're a Haringey run school teacher, you couldn't run as a candidate to become a councillor in Haringey. But other than those restrictions, which are all published, then no, it's down to you and managing your own time and how you want to do that. This is assuming that your employer doesn't have a problem with it as well.
Great, thank you very much. Councillor Adamu, can I get a perspective from you on how you juggle, because you've been a councillor for a very long time, how you juggle employment, family, your role in the community and as a councillor?
When I first started out, as I said, I had children, I was working. I was actually still doing a course at college, and I knew something was going to give. So I discussed it and then at the time with my husband, and I decided to reduce my hours of working, basically. So I cut down on working at the time. And I have to say, at the time, we never had any money. The only money councillors claimed was for their petrol money and the money for telephone expenses. That's all it is. So it's really peanuts every month just to pay your petrol or your fares if you needed to travel. So it wasn't done for money. It was done because of passion and commitment. But over the years, you know, my circumstances have changed. And it depends what you do as well. Every year, we need different, we need to spend different times at the council. But we, apart from the official meetings, what people didn't say was that we have meetings that you don't see on the council calendar. We have group meetings, labor group meetings, labor group, we have working parties. We have a lot of, and from September to Christmas time, it's very busy because we have to set up the budget. We have a lot of meetings, sometimes one or two a week. So we can spend, from September to Christmas, we can spend quite a lot of hours every week at meetings. The set-up meetings, committee meetings, and that, council meetings, but also the meetings you don't see on the calendar, which are on budgets, group meetings, working group meetings, and other. Sometimes you have more of them than we have the what they call official meeting. But there is no doubt that working and being on the council, if you have family, is difficult. But I did it, and I'm not sorry for it. My children got to know their mom was interested in other things, and it's a good example for the children to see their parents being involved and interested and talk about life outside the home and the work. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Adamu. The next question is going to Councillor Armett. So, Councillor Armett, do you need any formal qualifications to be a councillor? And then more generally, what are the most important skills do you think involved in being a councillor?
Answer is no. And I did actually mean to say this in my initial intro. You don't. You just have to be somebody that wants to get involved, wants to get active, and is keen to make a difference in your community. There are people from various backgrounds on the council, various job roles, you know, everything from lawyers to, well, we don't have any doctors, although we do have pharmacists, actually. You know, it lots and lots of roles and positions. So no, you don't need any formal qualifications. In terms of skill set, what I will say is, you know, you do have to be, you know, you do have to be committed, you do have to be pretty patient, and you do have to be willing to put in the time and the effort. You know, you do have to do a lot of reading. I mean, I'm not going to say you have to be the best public speaker, but certainly it does involve, you know, speaking to residents and occasionally speaking to groups of people. And some of us are a bit better and a bit more confident at that. But actually, that they are things that you can be supported with as well. And good listening skills, because as some of my colleagues have outlined, a lot of the time you are picking up lots of casework and there's lots of issues and people will come to speak to you about various things at your surgery. So good listening skills. The ability to problem solve, I think that's a key skill.
Great, thank you. I'm just going to get a perspective on that same question from a couple of other people, starting with Councillor Jogi. So Councillor Jogi, what do you think important skills are?
Sorry, Zina, I missed the last
question. What do you think the most important skills to be a councillor are? Yeah.
Well, I think the first one is probably passion to want to help other people. And that's not meant to be just words, but there is a certain skill set there to want to tap into other people's issues and try to help them. The leader's touched on it by being a good listener. And I suppose also it's having, what's the phrase I'm looking for? Well, a mixture of tenacity, but also patience, because it can take a little while to get things done through members' inquiries, which is our system of raising issues. As councillors, and the chief executive leader will know some of my thoughts on the speed on occasion, but tenacity and patience, because sometimes you can't always get an issue done immediately, and it does require you to go to different people, or you know, I may need to speak to Luke and Tammy about issues that border Hornsey and Crouch End, and that means you have to, you know, delay perhaps going as speedily as you might have wanted to. And I suppose also there's an element of maturity. I don't mean that in a silly sense, but you know, I may have political disagreements with people in my own party or with people in other parties, but actually once you're a councillor, you do require or you are required to kind of put away the partisan element of all this, because ultimately there are 57 of us. We're all there to serve the people of Haringey, and you have to work with people who you may not like or agree with on everything, but they're the people that the people of our community elected, and you know, we all got thrown into the pot and we've got to make the best of it. So yeah, I think the leader touched on the most important points, but I think tenacity, patience, and that level of maturity and balance is also really important too.
Thank you very much. Councillor Palmer, have you got anything to add to any of that?
Yeah, I suppose if I could pick up on the scrutiny role and perhaps sort of some of the skills that are needed there. And so in scrutiny, you're often reading a lot of paperwork and your job is to scrutinise. So having some really good analytical skills, making sure that you're kind of reading, that you're able to ask the right questions, you know, that those really kind of probing questions in scrutiny to get the right answer. And sometimes you do have to be quite tenacious, as Adam says, in those meetings to kind of keep probing until you get the response that you need. I think the other thing for me, so obviously doing the children and family stuff, I deal with quite a lot of the safeguarding issues that come up in some of our wards. And there's a real skill in dealing with very sensitive, you know, and all councillors will have to deal with really sensitive things. And I think there's something about showing empathy, about being very pragmatic sometimes when you're faced with sometimes really, really difficult, you know, really upsetting kind of traumatic information. And actually your role is to kind of, you know, assess the fact, you know, get the facts and try and support the individuals. And as Adam says, you know, you might have to put members' inquiries in and kind of work through. And sometimes you're giving very difficult news back to people as well. And so there's something for me in just having that great empathy, but also being very pragmatic and calm when you're dealing with those things. It's not going to help anybody if you're sort of hysterical.
Thank you very much. And Councillor Palmer, I'm going to sit with you because you came into the council not that many years ago. The question we've got is, I've never been a councillor before. Won't I be confused if I don't know what's going on? And you probably remember that feeling.
Oh, yeah. Oh, gosh. Yeah. That first day, I'm sure Adam and Perry will remember as well, their first day of going to get all of their equipment. It was just probably one of the most confusing hours of my life, actually, just being handed lots of equipment and kind of being, you know, even though I came from sort of a really professional background, I've never done anything like this before, and there's no kind of handbook that says, well, here's how you deal with this inquiry. You're suddenly the port of call for the people in your ward, and you kind of learn. And I have to say, you know, again, I think there's this idea that we all kind of don't like each other, but actually lots of the Labour councillors and our own councillors as well, who are far more experienced than us, are incredibly supportive to new people. You know, I remember like sort of doing some of my first scrutiny meetings with lots of Labour councillors who had a lot more experience. I mean, they're incredibly helpful. So I think it takes a little while to adjust and kind of get used to things, but you do quite quickly, actually. And there is always somebody to ask for help.
Great, thank you very much. And we also have a fairly extensive member training programme that starts to take people through the basics so that some of that support is there as well. Thank you very much, Councillor Palmer. And the next question I'm going to put to Councillor Corley Harrison and then the leader. So the question is, if there are other applicants for the role of councillor, how will you make a decision? To Councillor Corley Harrison.
In what regard, sorry, if there are other applicants?
So I think it's really a question about the selection process and kind of how do you get selected to be a councillor?
Okay, so this will likely vary by political party in terms of selections. If you're running as an independent councillor, then as many independents can run in a particular ward as put in an application. If you are wanting to run as a candidate for a particular political party, then there will be likely a limit on the number of people that party puts forward for a particular ward, depending on how many vacancies are for that ward. So in Haringey, the majority of the wards have three seats. Some of them have two. I can't speak for the Labour group because I don't know how they're, I don't know what their mechanisms are for selecting candidates. But in the Liberal Democrats, we have a selection process where people put forward their applications for a particular seat, a particular ward, essentially. And the members of the local party vote for who they want as their candidates for that particular seat. And then those candidates will become the official Liberal Democrat candidates for whichever wards they're putting themselves forwards for. There are, you know, certain restrictions or limits on who can do that. You know, for example, you have to be a Liberal Democrat member for a certain period of time, etc. But the process is set out by the national party, as it were. So if it's a particular political group, then the best thing really is to go to that political group and find out the details, find out what their process is, what their timeline is, even. Some do it quite early. So you might want to get in there nice and early and say you're interested in a particular ward or area and running as a candidate in that particular space. But the actual formal kind of deadline for nominations to the council isn't until about a couple of months, I think it is, before polling day at the start of May, so around the start of March 2022.
Thank you very much. And I'll ask Fiona in a minute to say a bit more about that formal process. Councillor Armick, can I just ask you to just comment on the selection process as well, please?
Yeah, so quite similar to what Luke has already said. So the Labour Party has its own selection process with certain criteria, one of which is that you would have had to have been a Labour member for over a year, although there can be special circumstances. But you have to have been a member for a year, and we have wards, you know, our local parties are based on wards, what we call branch Labour parties. And essentially you apply, you apply to a specific, so you've got a panel, you're interviewed by a panel, you've got to get through that phase. Once you get through that, then you apply to a specific ward, and then the members, we have what we call hustings, so it could be more than one applicant. One of our seats is what we term is reserved for a woman. It's a quota. Obviously we want more than one woman in each ward, and Councillor Adamu's ward is three women actually, but we have one ward which is a women's quota, and then people come and you're asked a series of questions, you're given a speech, and then you're selected in that ward, and then you're officially a candidate. But there's more to it, and as I said, I'd advise getting in touch with your local party directly.
Great. Thank you very much. And of course, other parties, Conservatives, Green Party, and the variety of other parties that there are, also have variants on that selection process. So as both Councillor Armett and Councillor Corley Harrison said, best to get in touch with the party to find a bit more about it. I've got one or two other questions, and then I'm going to bring Fiona in to talk about the technical details. But the next question, Councillor Armett, is from one of our live viewers, who said you'd mentioned that you did need to do quite a lot of reading. Do you want to just expand on that? Is it really important? Do you need to read everything? How do you decide what to read and what you can perhaps just skim over?
So I guess everyone's different, how we retain information and how we access information. It would be different for everybody. But you have to read, because you have to understand the issue. So you have to have an understanding of, if you're on a committee, planning committee is obviously an example where you've got quite a lot of papers. And I think as you get more used to the role, you will then decide whether or not you do need to go through it word by word, or whether you can skim read. And as I said, everyone has a very different approach to the way they do these things, whether it's academically, whether it's in your work life. And it's the same as being a councillor. So some will go through it word by word, others will look at selective information, and you know, and I think you learn with experience, so that comes in time. But reading and understanding the issues, I think, is absolutely important.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's a really important part of our decision-making process, isn't it? Knowing that everybody who's going in to either make a decision or scrutinise the decision is fully cognizant of all the facts of the case.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring Fiona Alderman in, and Fiona can introduce herself and explain her role to just explain a bit more of the kind of technical details of how you become a councillor, the requirements of being a councillor, and then if there are any other questions that people watching the live feed have got, please do put them into the chat, either for Fiona or for other members. For members. I've got one or two more questions that were pre-submitted to put to members, and then we'll draw to a close. So, Fiona.
Thanks, Zina. So how do you become a councillor? So as you've heard, you would need to stand for election. Haringey councillors, 57 councillors, and each elected by and representing a small part of the borough called a ward. We're going to have new wards which will come into effect in May 2021, meaning that Haringey will have 21 wards as opposed to the current 19. Some wards will elect three councillors and some will elect two. So the next local elections are in May 2022. Elections are held in all wards every 4 years on the first Thursday in May. From time to time, there may be by-elections which are caused by councillors resigning or the death of a councillor. So in terms of running elections, each authority appoints the returning officer to take overall control of its elections. The day-to-day work is usually managed by electoral services staff, and it is these staff that candidates and agents are likely to have the most dealings with during the course of the election. So you can be a candidate if you are over 18 and a British citizen, a Commonwealth citizen, or a citizen of a country which is a member of the European Union, and you are either on the electoral register for Haringey Council or for at least the whole of the 12 months before nomination day, you match one of the following. You live within the borough of the Haringey as an owner or tenant. Your principal or only place of work is within the borough of Haringey. You have occupied as owner or tenant land or premises within the borough of Haringey. So we'll come at the end of the presentation to what the key dates are so you understand which is the nomination day. You cannot become a candidate if you are bankrupt, you have a criminal conviction which has a minimum penalty of 3 months in prison or more, you work for Haringey Council or hold paid office under the authority, including joint boards or committees, or hold a politically restricted post with another local authority. You also can't be a candidate if you have been disqualified under the Representation of the People Act, which relates to certain election offences act. What would it cost me to stand for election? So you don't have to pay a deposit to stand as a candidate in local council elections. However, you need to keep careful records of all expenditure on your campaign, as these have to be accounted for at the end of the process. If you want to represent a political party, then as you've heard, you'll need to contact and join the local political party. They will be able to advise you on their councillor selection criteria. Many political parties will start their selection process in summer 2021 for the elections in 2022. If you want to stand as an independent candidate, you can do. And for general information on independent councillors, the Local Government Association Independent Councillors website is worth looking at. You can also get various information from the Electoral Commission website as well. So in terms of the process, if you do decide to stand for election, to become a candidate, you must complete a nomination paper during the nomination period, and we'll come back to the dates at the end. Nomination papers will be available from the election team by early March 2022. Before you can be accepted as a candidate, you must complete a nomination paper and you must have one person to agree to propose your nomination, another person to agree to second the proposal, and the support of eight other people. All of these people must be on the electoral register for the ward in which you wish to stand. It is advisable to submit the nomination papers well in advance of the deadline to allow time for any unintended errors to be corrected or a fresh nomination to be submitted. So if you are putting in a nomination paper, meeting with the election team early is always recommended, because once the deadline has passed, it's not possible to correct any errors, and it may be that then your nomination is not valid. So If you want to find out more details, then the returning officer will arrange a briefing meeting for candidates and agents closer to the election. It provides an opportunity for discussion of any issues relating to the election and explain any recent changes in legislation or any local arrangements. The forms for nomination and guidance notes can be obtained a few weeks before polling day from the electoral services team. We strongly advise anyone interested in standing for election to provide their contact details to the electoral services team. This will ensure you are emailed in advance of any future election with details of the nomination process, and details are on our website. So, practicalities, new ward boundaries will be in place next year. Think about which ward you would like to stand to represent. If you want to stand for a party, they need to select you, so contact them to find out more about the process. Ensure that you prepare all the relevant paperwork and book an appointment by contacting the elections team, who can perhaps help you with doing some informal checks beforehand. So in terms of key dates, the notice of election is 28th of March 2022. The nomination process will run from 29th of March until 4 p.m. on the 4th of April. Election day is Thursday, the 5th of May 2022, and the count will take place on the Friday. So I'll just pause now before I move on to a second presentation and just see if there's any questions.
I don't think we've got any specifically about that, Fiona, although I'm sure having heard that amount of information, people might want to just take it away, and I'm sure they might have questions afterwards. So if people have got questions afterwards, where should they address them?
So those can be sent to the election team, which is elections.admin@haringey.gov.uk.
Lovely, thank you very much. And we can post that in the chat so people have got it as well.
Yeah. So once you've been successfully elected as a councillor, I just thought I'd give an overview of the support that is available from the local authority. So there is induction and training that's provided. There's access to space in council offices, such as a members' room, and you'll also receive office equipment such as a mobile phone, laptop and printer. You'll receive access to media and general communications advice on your work as a councillor, and you also there may be some research support available. This is usually provided via political assistant, and each group has a political assistant. The leader and cabinet have dedicated support to assist them with their roles. So the training that we provide will let you know where to access information and guidance. Officers will also provide briefings on key issues, and sometimes there will be joint events with officers to formulate strategy and good working relationships. Training can also build specific skills, for example, scrutiny committees, media skills, influencing. The council can also assist councillors with support in accessing counselling for general welfare and health. So from an officer perspective, we've got a duty to ensure that councillors have access to the information they need in order to make well-informed decisions. They may do this by producing factual reports, making presentations or arranging visits. So for example, if you were a councillor sitting on planning committee, then you could be expected to visit a site that is a subject of a planning application. In terms of funding, all councillors are entitled to a basic allowance, which is set each year. And those with additional roles may also receive a special responsibility allowance, which reflects the level of responsibility and expected time commitment. Allowances are set by the council on the recommendation of an independent remuneration panel, and they may also cover the cost of childcare or dependent care, along with travel and subsistence. So allowances are subject to income tax, and it's your responsibility to ensure that you pay the correct amount. And there is a level of tax relief that could be applied for as well. For example, the use of a home office and telephone. So I hope that gives you an overview of the sort of support that's available if you are successfully elected. Thank you very much. Now I'll hand back to Zina.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Before you hand back, I think you forgot to introduce yourself at the beginning. So do you just want to explain?
Oh, sorry. Yes, sure. So, I'm Fiona Alderman and I am the council's monitoring officer, which means that I'm the council's most senior lawyer.
Great, thank you very much. Members, I'm coming back to you with a few more questions. The first one is from somebody who's on our live chat, and it says, when you're wanting to become a councillor, you've been selected. Is campaigning like MPs go about campaigning? Does it involve door knocking, canvassing, hustings, that kind of thing? I'm just going to pick on a couple of people to say a bit more about what that process is like. I'm going to start with Councillor Jogi.
Thanks, Chief Executive. Yes, in short, it is. I don't think there's an MP approach per se. I think there's a political party approach generally. Each political party will do things differently, but there is a basic structure to campaigning. Some like to deliver leaflets, some like to door knock, some like to do both. Some others like to have a kind of a Facebook, social media jazz, and that tends to be those who don't have many people out on the campaign trail. But ultimately, yeah, it's speaking to as many people as possible. I remember when I became chair of my local Labour Party in Hornsey in 2010, I essentially would write a handwritten note to every single person I spoke to. So by 2014, most of them knew who I was. And even if they didn't like me, they couldn't get rid of me. But it's about forming that contact and that connection with people. And I suppose the main reason for being a councillor is to tap into people's issues, address their concerns and try and deliver results. And you can only find out what all of those different elements are if you're out speaking, engaging with people. So, I was out in my ward before I joined this very important call with my two ward colleagues, speaking to residents and meeting a couple of chairs of associations. So it's that constant contact. It doesn't always have to be knocking on someone's door, but it's being out and about. It's increasingly, as Luke and Tammy will testify, it's responding on the Crouch End Appreciation Society, which covers a number of roads in our N8 postcode. But it's about being seen and being active and being engaged, and there's many different ways to do it.
Great, thank you very much. And since you've mentioned Councillor Palmer, I'll bring Councillor Palmer in to answer the same question.
Yeah, so I think, as Adam says, campaigning is kind of one of the most important things that you'll do kind of before you get elected and once you get elected as well. So it's a really, really busy time. So I think you have to kind of put aside time in the evenings, time at weekends. So we do lots of door knocking, and I'm sure in other political parties it's exactly the same. So we get lots of training. We do not send anybody off on their own to begin with. It can be quite intimidating knocking on someone's door if you've never done it before. So you'll always be buddied up until you're confident about doing it. There's leaflet delivery. I think both political parties actually do street stalls, which is another brilliant way of getting to meet local residents. And then I think, as Adam says, sort of once you're elected, that doesn't stop. You know, you're constantly, so we're always out and about in Crouch End, kind of chatting with business owners. We still do street stalls. We're still doing leaflet deliveries, door knocking. And it's a really good way of picking up issues. So even before we were elected, we were picking up kind of issues in particular areas like potholes or, you know, where there were issues that needed kind of sorting out for residents, we could pass those on. And that's really, really important. You won't get to know your ward or the people that live in it if you're not out kind of living and breathing it. So you're always campaigning in some form or another.
Great, thank you very much, Councillor Palmer. Next question is for Fiona, a slightly more technical question. And Fiona, the question is, do you have to live full-time in Haringey before election and whilst you're a councillor?
Thanks, Zina. So at the point where you're standing to be a candidate, for at least you need to be the certain criteria you've got to have. One of them is for at least the whole of the 12 months before nomination day, you must match one of the following. So you live within the borough of Haringey as owner or tenant, your principal or only place of work is within the borough of Haringey, or you've occupied as an owner or tenant land or premises within the borough of Haringey. So the answer is it's not always necessary to actually live there, but you do need to meet one of those criteria. So, for example, if you worked in Haringey, then that might be the box that you tick. But it's as well to take advice on which box you should tick, whether you should tick more than one. So I hope that answers the question.
Thank you very much, Fiona. And then the last question that I've got, I think, and I'm going to ask all the councillors for their perspective on this, because you're all different people and you'll all have your own reasons. And the question is, how do I know that being a councillor is for me? I'm going to start with Councillor Armit.
I guess before most people become councillors, I think we all go, oh, I'm not sure if it's something I want to do. But I think, you know, it's a lot of work to get to the point where you actually become a councillor. And I think if you've had the dedication, time and commitment to go through the various forms, put yourself forward, then it is for you. But I'll go back to my starting point, which is, you know, passion and commitment to your local area. It starts there.
Thank you, Councillor Armit. Councillor Adamell, I'm going to go to you next. You said that every 4 years when you restand as a councillor, you think, do I want to do this again? So what is it that keeps you doing it again?
The reason I ask myself that is because it become more and more difficult, the work of councillors, in the sense of the decisions you have to make. Since I've been a councillor, it's such a big change in the funding we get from government. We have something like 40% cut of funding is reduced by 40% from the government. So we have to make some really tough decisions. Decisions that as a Labour councillor find difficult at times, because we're elected to help and develop our services and so on, and we have a great difficulty. So we're always trying to protect our frontline services, and it is becoming difficult. On that issue, that's the reason sometimes I ask myself if I want to do it. Why I carry on doing it, as I said before, is to do with the difference I made. And the difference I make in people's lives is when, you know, individual when they come to see me. And at the end of the day, it's better to have people who care about Haringey make those difficult questions, the decisions, I should say, decisions, than people who don't. So as difficult as may be, if you care about Haringey, it's better we are part of that decision making than not. And I think that's the reality of it. And I'm very committed and I'm very enthusiastic about the work we do in the borough. And the minute I lose that, that's the minute I won't be standing again. And so thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Adamy. Just because you're there, I'll ask another question that's come up on the live chat, which is, if English is my second language, how am I going to be able to, am I going to be able to manage with all of the reading and writing that's required?
Yes. I mean, if you can read and write and you can speak, there is no reason why you shouldn't. I personally have an accent, for instance. And even though I've been here most of my life, because at home we spoke Greek and I was the oldest of my sisters, I got the accent where my sisters don't have an accent. So when I first went on the council, I have to say I found it a little bit difficult, because some people, they hear the accent, they don't look at the human being. They make assumptions about you. They think you can't be as bright or as educated because you have an accent. So I found I had to work twice as hard to prove that I had a brain in my head and the accent is part of me, it's who I am. I'm British and I'm Cypriot. And that's it. So please don't allow being English second language to stop you. Really, you have a lot more to give, you know, than you think you have. And I would say, please, don't let us stop you, really don't. I think you should go for it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councillor Adamy. Councillor Palmer, how did you know that being a councillor was for you?
So I actually wanted to, I think as I said at the beginning, make a real change. So things like the environment, education, inequality, they're things that I've kind of dealt with in my professional career, lots of things that I've done as an activist.
I actually wanted to go down the MP route, so that's actually what I explored before being a councillor, and I hadn't really thought very much. I hadn't really understood how much difference you could make locally. I just really didn't understand very well. And I think once I really did understand the impact that you could make at a local level and how you could really help transform people's lives, I knew that I really wanted to become a councillor. So I think you have to be really dedicated, committed. Like I said, campaigning is really hard work. You're away from your family. If you've got a job as well, it can be really, really challenging. But I think the difference that you'll make, however long you choose to be a councillor, is kind of something that you'll take away with you forever. Just knowing that being a councillor has allowed you to be part of an administration that has done something to transform lives in Haringey. That's a really amazing thing.
Thank you very much, Councillor Palmer. Councillor Jogi, have you got any closing thoughts on how you know being a councillor is for you?
Well, in my own personal sense, it was a mixture of wanting to change the world, having a big mouth, and not wanting to study any longer to be a lawyer. So it was a case of seeing how else I could advocate for people without having to study again. But I think most importantly for anyone who's listening or who isn't listening, but someone may tell them, is we all live, learn and work here. Whatever happens, unless you choose not to, but you're still going to live here. So if you have an issue you're bothered about, a fight you want to wage or something you want to improve, get involved, get active. And irrespective of which party it is or no party, it's probably a bit more difficult being independent because you can't deliver 10,000 leaflets on your own unless you're some supersonic person. The leader probably could now I say it. But in all seriousness, however you want to contribute, do so. And there'll be plenty of people around to help you do it.
Thank you very much, Councillor Jogi. And then a same question to Councillor Corley Harrison.
I'd say if you're one of those people that's always an armchair critic, you're probably halfway there, because that means you have half an interest in politics of some kind, even if you might not necessarily see it as politics. So certainly I was one of those, and it was a case of, well, do you moan from, you know, your own home, or do you get out there and make a difference? And I'd say go out there and try, because as has already been said, it's an awful lot of work before you get elected anyway, which almost acts as a trial period, and you'll get that buzz back, you know, if you go out there, pick up issues, get them resolved, start to understand what people are talking about, what matters to them. And if you want to then help them, I mean, that is really the crux of it. I'd say that for a lot of people that do it as part of a political party as well, there is some sense of ideology behind what they're doing. Lots of people obviously want to make a difference to their local area, but they are doing it on the wave of whatever, you know, fundamental principles they believe in, and where that aligns. And that's a big factor for a lot of people. They want to make a difference as part of their political party at all levels, because they believe that's the best way to make the best change. But you will also get that affirmation back from your residents. You know, if they're thanking you for things and you think, well, this is great, I'm really making a difference, before you become elected, I'd say you're well on your way. If at that point you say, do you know what, this isn't for me, then you've given it a go and you've not necessarily committed all the way. So, you know, go out there, get campaigning, see if you can pick up some issues, see if you can make a difference before you become a councillor, and use that as a trial to kind of really make a difference. And also reach out to existing councillors, speak to them and see what, you know, where your concerns may be, whether they can be allayed or talked through or whatever else, because we're all here happy to help and happy to kind of talk and listen to people. You're muted, Zina.
Thank you. It's the first time I've done that for a long time. I thought I'd got the hang of this digital thing. Thank you very much, Councillor Corley Harrison. Can I say a really big thank you to everybody who's taken part in our event today, and a really big thank you to councillors for being part of it. We have videoed or recorded the whole event. So the whole event will go onto our YouTube channel, so that you can watch it again, or you can recommend it to your friends as well, so that anybody who hasn't been able to be part of the event today but who wants to know a bit more about being a councillor is able to do so. And as we've said at various points during the event, there are lots of different places where you can send your questions, and obviously councillors have offered help if you've got questions to go direct to them as well. So a big thank you to everybody for joining us today, and that brings our event to a close.
Are we all still here?
I think we finished.